My name is Liz Nordland, and I'm a member of the White Bear Area League of Women Voters, but a resident of the city of Grant. And I will be moderating the forum this evening. As a trusted volunteer nonpartisan organization, the League of Women Voters does not support or oppose political parties or candidates. We sponsor forums like this to provide voters an opportunity to hear candidates' views about issues of interest in the upcoming election. For more information about the Minnesota League, please visit our website at lwvmn.org. The order of speaking tonight has been determined by a drawing of numbers and will be rotated thereafter. Candidates' remarks are being timed to ensure quality of time. Questions are being collected from the audience. There are two candidates for senator. The registered candidates are for state senator, Dwayne Johnson, and Chuck Leader. For House Representative 43A, Peter Fisher and Stacy Stout. So we'll now begin with opening statements, and we will begin with Dwayne Johnson.
Hi, thank you for coming out tonight. My name is Dwayne Johnson. I am running for the Senate in Senate District 43. I live here in White Bear Lake. My wife and I moved here about a year ago, and her name is Paula, and with a little luck, and if I keep walking the line, Sunday we will be celebrating our 40th wedding anniversary. We have three adult children and seven grandchildren. I work as an accountant. After I got out of the Marine Corps, I worked in several industries as an accountant for the last 30 years. And the last 5 years, I've been a tax accountant. I've got an office over in Maple Grove, Minnesota. By seeing the devastation caused on some of my clients by the high taxes and the poor economy in this area, and that is the reason that I'm running for Senate. I am running on basically three goals. Number one is to reduce the Minnesota state budget. It's getting out of hand and it needs to be reduced. The second thing is to stem the loss of jobs in Minnesota and create a climate where all Minnesotans can have a prosperous and enjoyable place to live. The third thing is to prioritize the school and higher education budgets so that we can develop more and brighter students in this area to draw new businesses into this area where I want to come here because of our educated populace. Thank you again for coming out tonight.
Thank you. Next with his opening statement is Chuck Weger.
Hello everyone, and to the viewers at home, my name is Chuck Weger. I'm currently serving as a state senator. I'm a lifelong resident, a fourth generation in this area, raised in North St. Paul, graduate of North High. My educational journey took me to the University of Minnesota, to Hamlin, to the University of Colorado Boulder. I have a Bachelor of Arts and a law degree. I'm an attorney. I work at Securian, the largest private employer in St. Paul. Prior to that, I managed several areas of the Chamber of Commerce. I have five children. They're adults, and three grandchildren, and one on the way any minute. I am running primarily for re-election for many of the same goals that you mentioned, Dwayne, that being the jobs and the economy. There's no doubt that is the most important issue that we need to focus on, and I would tie that in with education, because you have to have a qualified workforce, you have to match the skills with those that are out there. And in fact, today we had a meeting with the White Bear Area Chamber of Commerce, a number of representatives from the area higher education, the superintendents from different schools, employers, and talking how we can better match the skills that are out there with what's needed, and I'm sure we'll have an opportunity to expand. In terms of volunteer work, I've been involved in, whether it's on Parks Commission, serving on my parish council for a couple of terms. I chair the school board in North St. Paul, Maplewood, Oakdale. I chair the Ramsey Soil and Water Conservation District. I get involved and usually am put in a position of leadership because I'm a consensus builder, and I do my very best to do that, and I'll probably be pointing to some of those things during the forum. If there's any point that's not covered tonight that you would like more information or want to share a concern, please call me. My number is 651-770 0283, or email charles.wieger@yahoo.com.
Thank you. Those are your two candidates for Senate District 43. Now we will hear opening statements from our two candidates for House District 43A, and we will begin with Stacy Stout.
Good evening. Thank you to the League of Women Voters for hosting this event, and thank all of you for being here. I'm Stacy Stout. I live here in Montemita with my husband Tim, and our two boys, Jackson, who will soon be 5 years old, and Ethan, who is 3 years old. Our boys are fourth generation Minnesotans, and it's important to us to be raising them in this community. We are members of St. Andrew's Church, and I'm on the White Bear Area YMCA Community Board. I work at the Minnesota Farm Bureau, a grassroots organization, and I handle federal legislative and regulatory policy there. For over 12 years as an attorney, I've worked in public policy. I worked at the United States House of Representatives, the United States Senate, and the United States Department of Justice, where I worked with leadership of both parties. And I understand the importance of having a solutions-oriented approach in the legislative process. I am running for this seat because I believe in service, hard work, discipline, and personal responsibility. My parents ran their own business and worked really hard to ensure that I would have quality education. And I'm the first person in my family to get a college degree. I have a law degree, and while in law school, I was a Rotary Scholar. And I grew as a leader in service to others and understand the importance of this role in serving our community. As a representative, I will work for quality education, job growth, fiscally responsible government, and lower taxes. I think it's my ability to problem solve, to respect different opinions, and have a collaborative, effective approach to problem solving, those are the strengths that I'll take to our state capitol. I'll be a principled voice for our community, and I would be honored to have your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Next with his opening statement is Peter Fisher.
Good evening. My name is Peter Fisher. I want to thank the League for having this opportunity for us tonight. You that are here and you that are home that are watching us, appreciate the opportunity. I've had a great opportunity over the last few months to meet many of you in the district, but there's some that I haven't met yet. So I'd like to tell a little bit about myself, my background, where I've come from. First of all, I've grown up in the area. I've got deep roots. My great-grandparents originally settled on a farm over off Highway 61 and 36. We've got a lot of ties in the area. I've been very active in the local communities. I've served in the City of Maplewood on the Parks Commission for over 18 years and on the Human Relations Commission for 5 years before that. I served as chair of both commissions, and I learned a lot of important things during that time. Most importantly is being able to work together with people, listening to people, to be able to solve the problems that we had before us on those commissions. Some other areas of expertise that I bring that I think will be very helpful at the state capitol is number one, is I spent over 30 years in the private sector, working in businesses, small businesses, running and managing them. Learned a lot of different things and some of the challenges that businesses have. 5 years ago, I took a little change. I went into the nonprofit world to help a homeless youth shelter that was suffering from state budget cuts. I was able to go in using my business background, my degrees from the University of St. Thomas, I was able to go in and financially save the organization, turn around. And was being done with a balanced approach, taking a look at the hard decisions we have to make on the expense side and also on the revenue side. And these are some things I think are very important. Something I think we've lost at the Capitol the last few years is bringing a balanced approach. This balanced approach will solve our problems in terms of the revenue side, in terms of how we address our education issues. We've borrowed from our schools very heavily, and we don't have a good answer for paying that back. We owe it to our children to be able to do that. I think that is one of the important things I bring. I appreciate your consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. Our first question is on health care. What is the role of the legislature in making health care accessible and affordable? And we'll begin with Chuck Wieger.
It's very important that healthcare be accessible and affordable for everyone. And I believe that has been declared at the national level very clearly. And in fact, there's one quote I will just share at the conclusion of this. We have a number of programs that provide a safety net, but we still have people that can't get covered. And through the federal programs, we've been able to Finally, for those people that have pre-existing conditions, there's going to be coverage. Students that may not have found a job yet or a job that didn't offer benefits can be offered that type of coverage. But I think it's very important that you have access to it. And it was summarized, and actually I was going to use a quote about why we should do something at all levels, and it was offered very eloquently by Mitt Romney.
Thank you. Next is Peter Fisher.
It's very important that we have accessible, affordable health care from several different areas. I think that, number one, it's important that we have our children covered. I have 3 children right now that are in college. But I'm glad that we have the change in the health law that know that I don't have to worry about what's going to happen to my kids' health care as they're getting through and finishing their degrees. That's very important. Number two, I work with a segment of the population that in the past too often has not had the opportunity for health care. And the unfortunate part is when they don't have the opportunity for health care, they end up in a situation where they're accessing health care through the emergency room, the most expensive way of doing it. I think we need to take a look at that, making sure that we're focusing the resources and educating the people at the same time so they can learn how to access the health care system properly, and also having the resources so they don't have to wait until it's a crisis. The more preventative that we can be beforehand, the better off we are, and the healthier are, and the lower cost we have in health care.
Thank you. The question next goes to Wayne Johnson.
Well, this is an area, obviously, that is quite important. Because tax season only goes for 3 months out of the year, I have taken another part-time job at Target to just keep me busy during the year, but also to get insurance. But because of Obamacare, my hours have now been cut so that next year I might not be able to receive the insurance through Target. And this is why we have to really look at what we're doing when we pass laws so that everybody gets, and we can cover everybody, but we have to watch out for those those consequences that we don't realize are out there. So we have to really, really look at all sides of something before we pass a law that's going to cover everyone. I hope this is the answer you're looking for, but I am really concerned about health care. I've got a son who works in an emergency room. He did for 15 years at Hennepin County Medical Center.
Thank you. Stacy Stone.
I think obviously we all agree that affordable, accessible, quality care is very important. And we've actually done a really good job in Minnesota. We have one of the lowest uninsured rates of any state, and our state ranks among the top tiers. So I think what we want to be careful of is with the federal system coming into place, we want to make sure that it doesn't override what we're already doing right in our state, because we want to ensure that the quality care that we get remains the same, and the accessibility and the affordability of it are in place for everybody who needs medical care. And so I think that's the main thing, is that we just make sure that we keep doing right what we are, and that we improve upon the things that can be improved upon, but not at the expense of anybody's access to quality care.
Thank you. I'll now give the candidates the opportunity for up to 30 seconds for rebuttal time. So does anyone have any additional comments? All right, we'll move on to the second question. There are about 15,000 people seeking shelter on any given night in Minnesota, and half of them are children. What can you do to promote affordable housing and or prevent foreclosures and homelessness? And we will begin with Stacy Stone.
The housing issue is it's a very important, critical issue at this time. I've been door knocking through our entire district, and I see a number of foreclosed homes. I know that people, this is unlike any other time that we've seen as far as the number of people who are forced into another situation, one that they did not foresee. And in Washington County, we have about 100 homeless youth. And I think that there needs to be an approach on a number of levels. One, with the housing issue, we've got to determine how to help people stay in their homes. But beyond that, when they've already become homeless, we've got to address those needs and help them get back into a situation where they're in their communities and able to succeed in that community so that they can improve, not only get back into their house, but we have to address it from all levels as far as helping them get back to work and give them the needs that they, address the needs that they have so that they can get back into the community that they live in.
Thank you. Chuck Uyghur.
First, support those groups like the East Metro Council, and there's a number of programs right here in our neighborhood that are providing this safety net for people. But how can that be addressed long-term? Having good jobs is very important, but we have people as well that have had good jobs, but they have lost their house, and that, you mentioned the door knocking where people were, the saddest thing I saw was where I saw the babies, toys and things, everyone was out, but they left that behind. It's just so sad. The problem is that there were a lot of people that probably weren't suitable in terms of the amount of money they had for the mortgage, and for those lenders that made those, shame on them, and for the bankers that allowed that type of a situation to happen, and then it just, the greed got out of control. We've got to have a sharper penalties in terms of the, you know, what's done in the whole practice for the mortgage process, and then that will help prevent the problem that we had where people were in a position where they were likely to fail.
Thank you. Peter Fisher.
There's a number of components that go into homelessness. Having worked with homeless youth on a regular basis, there's several things that we're facing. It's not just the foreclosures that are happening out there, but it's also the cuts that have come through the state government over the past few years. Things that impact us greatly. Number one is a number of programs that used to help some of the support, help some of the homeless people have been cut, and as a result, they don't have the supportive housing they need to be successful. As a result, they end up on the streets or in our local criminal justice system. Some of the other areas that is greatly impacting is that in many instances where people have lost their homes, they have problem finding affordable rental housing to go into that can house their entire family. And as a result, families are being broken up. We need to find ways to get more affordable housing, supporting affordable housing within the community that will provide enough bedrooms so that the families can stay together instead of being split apart. It's a very complex issue, but it's something that we have to work in partnership, not only with the government, but with local businesses in finding the solutions, because not any one agency has it, but by working together, we can find the solution to solve our problem.
Thank you. Dwayne Johnson.
Well, I saw this quite a bit during tax season this year of people who had lost their homes, and it's a very sad thing. We have to, long-term, obviously, have a better educated populace in Minnesota and more jobs. Short term, I wish there was something you could just put your finger on and say this will do it, but there isn't. We'll have to work as all of the groups that are working in the welfare area work together as a team to help these people to not only stay in a home, but also to get the necessary education they need to get another job, because a lot of the jobs that they have lost are gone forever. And it's going to take a combined effort of the government and welfare agencies and nonprofit organizations to fix this problem.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments? And we'll move on to the next question. Our current laws have allowed mentally unstable people to buy guns and ammo with resulting loss of life. How can we get control of the gun culture and restore a safe society? And we will begin with Peter Fisher.
I think the first thing that we have to make sure to focus on is that before any gun sales occurs, that we're doing thorough background checks. That's the number one thing, whether it's through a registered dealer or whether it's through private hands. I think that's one of the important things we have to take a look at. We also have to keep a balance on so that we're making sure that we're not infringing on those who are for hunting. We have to make sure that we're also carrying out and we're having coordination with people who are in the mental health arena, making sure that as they're running into people who may have issues, that it's getting into some kind of database. That is another area that we also have to keep in mind. It's a complex issue, but it's one that we have to work hard on, because we can't afford to have people not only who may have the unstable, but also have got violent criminal records in the background. That also needs to be kept in mind.
Thank you. Wayne Johnson.
I agree very much with what Mr. Fisher said, that we have to somehow have a database where those who sell guns can quickly check and find out if this person is suitable to purchase a gun. And it has to, we have to work with other states also, that somebody can't come in, it's got to be tied in federally. I'm not real big on all of our personal information getting put on a federal database, but there has to be a way of checking to make sure that whoever's purchasing a gun is not somebody who is prone to violence in our community.
Thank you. Chuck Weider.
I agree with Mr. Johnson's statement.
Thank you. Stacy Stowe.
I think it's a really important issue. We do have a federally run system, the NICS system, and I applaud our law enforcement. I think they do a great job. And I agree with what's been said. It has to be a balanced approach. We have a lot of hunters in our community, and we want to make sure that they are getting their, you know, access to their gun in a timely manner, and so we don't want the regulatory process to override that. But we want to make sure that we are weeding out people who should not be owning guns, because that's where the critical moment is, in making sure that they're in the right hands, and again, not infringing on anyone's personal right to own a gun.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments?
Well, Madam Moderator, yes. I would just add there was a lot of controversy when the legislature enacted concealed carry. I did vote for that. There was a large alarm that a lot of things were going to happen, and accidents and various killings. That didn't happen, and I think the key was that it was responsibly implemented with background checks, the due diligence that we had asked for, with lots of training by those that would have it and with the records. So with that, those safeguards in place, it's been implemented appropriately.
Anyone else? We'll move on to the next question. What is the role of the legislature in managing our water resources? And we will begin with Stacy Stout.
The role of legislature is to work with the communities, and we have a number of agencies as well that should be involved. As you know, as everyone here knows, we have a serious problem with the lake level in White Bear Lake, and it's really important. I know that all the communities around the lake and all the federal or all the state agencies that have any part in this situation have been involved. They've been doing a study. We've got to make sure that we get to a point where we know what the possible causes are and what the possible solutions are. And it has to have, we have to make sure that protecting our aquifers is a main element in how we decide to move forward.
Thank you. Chuck Weider.
The quality of water, the use of water is an international issue and one of the biggest concerns actually confronting the planet. And it's right here at home as well. And in terms of involvement of the state, we clearly, as a planner and wanting to safeguard our natural resources, want to have a very strong look in terms of what is put in place and for our various policies that we have. We look at the impact. For example, through the Metropolitan Council, have a development plan that's being put together on water resources. Commissioner Victoria Reinhart's the chair of that, and if you want to get information on what's being inventoried. Right here at home, we're awaiting now the results for White Bear Lake for the U.S. Geologic Survey. Just met with the city manager of White Bear today regarding that, as well as the other communities. There'll be a number of options, but keep in mind we have tripled the amount of water that's pumped out with the past generation, and we can't start conserving right now without any government involvement by doing more. So it's a very important issue and will be before us next year.
Thank you. Peter Fisher.
Several things that we have to keep in mind is in terms of managing water resources, that it comes from a number of different angles. Number one, invasive species. We've got a real problem with invasive species, whether it be zebra mussels or weeds that get into the area that go from one lake to another and cause it to be uninhabitable for our native plants and fish. So we have to manage our resources from that angle. Number two, we have to make sure that we're managing what's going to be happening in the future. We have talk of sulfide mining may be occurring up in northern Minnesota. In other areas where this has occurred, this has led to pollution runoff that has gone into the water system and damaged the water system. We cannot afford to have that happen without the proper safeguards. Number three, we've got to make sure that we're taking a strong look at what we're doing with our current aquifers right here. And it's not just here locally, it has to be coordinated regionally, because what's happening here will start happening in other parts of the metropolitan area, and this is the time to start be planning a wide-range state approach by using this as our example.
Thank you. Wayne Johnson.
Having lived in Arizona for a while and where there is no water, I do appreciate the water that we have in Minnesota. And also, I remember back when rivers in, I believe it was Ohio, used to catch on fire because the pollution that was dumped into them. And we've come a long way since then, but that doesn't mean that we quit now. Having seen what happened with White Bear Lake, I think this is a clue as to what we have to do, is get everybody who has an idea on it, get them all together and find out what all the facts are before we jump into something and do something that's going to work against us in the future. And that would be my approach.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments? Then we'll move on to the next question. There are two constitutional amendments on the ballot this year. What is your position on each amendment? If one or both are approved, what would be the financial and economic implications, if any, for the state and local governments? And we will begin with Dwayne Johnson.
Number one, they're already on the ballot, so I don't have any control over that. The marriage amendment, I got to say this right so it comes out right. If it is not passed, and we say marriage is between a man and a man, or a woman and a woman, whatever, this is going to affect the tax laws, possibly. And that will have an effect on, obviously, on how much people pay in taxes. I'm against it because I don't really want to change what God has said is marriage. I'm not against relationships, but we just have to put another name on it. It's not marriage. As far as the right to vote, I think it's very unfair to people to have their vote canceled out by somebody who does not have a legal right to vote in this country.
Thank you. Peter Fisher.
I'm against both amendments, and I think that for a number of reasons I'm against them. Is number one, that in terms of the marriage amendment, number one, if it fails in this election, nothing changes. We're still left with a system where the Supreme Court has ruled that marriage is defined as a man versus and a woman. My frustration is I have many of my friends who are same-gender relationships who are very committed in what they're doing, and it bothers me that if something happens to one of them, there's no guarantee that they can see their significant other. There's no guarantee that their assets will pass from one to another. In terms of the photo ID, I'm very concerned about the fact that it is not the best way to guarantee identity. As I've seen too many cases, when I used to work in the hospitality industry, is those that wanted to get in to a bar under the age of 21 were able to come up with a photo ID and be able to do that. I think we need to find a good way of making sure we have integrity, but I don't think the photo ID is the way to do it, because the people that want to are going to be able to find the false IDs to make it work.
Thank you. Chuck Wheeler.
I voted no when it was before the legislature for putting it on the ballot. I preferred that we focus on jobs during the session, and I thought that was supposed to be a laser focus by the controlling party, but we have this before us. So that said, on the marriage amendment, I support a person's right to enter a relationship, and my position has evolved over time, but as I have talked more and more to people, and I'll say I'm a Catholic, and these are Catholics also that support this, and we are divided, I understand, as a community. I thought former Governor Ian Carlson did a great job, not only on this issue, but on the voter ID issue. Dwayne, you mentioned tax implications. There's a number of benefits and other items, but the fact is it's already outlawed. You know, they're going to put a double lock on the door. So be it, it's up to the voters. I oppose the voter ID. That will cost money if it passes, and even more tragically, it's going to disenfranchise people, some students, it's going to disenfranchise some seniors and some military as well, because there's too many unanswered questions.
Thank you. Stacy Stout.
I think the constitutional amendments, both are important issues. I do agree that we're at a time when we have a very unstable economy. There's a lot of other issues on people's minds, and so I do question why we're having a constitutional amendment on an issue that's already our law. That said, I think it's an important issue, and I'm glad the voters will be able to vote. As far as the voter ID amendment, I think that's a little different in the sense that it's critically important that we protect a person's right to vote and that their vote is counted. If somebody goes and casts a vote at the ballot box fraudulently, it cancels out a legitimate vote. So on that issue, I think it's very important that we get this into our Constitution. And again, I don't think we should be amending our Constitution on a regular basis. I think there are a lot of issues that people are concerned about in our communities, such as Senator Weaker mentioned, the jobs and the economy. And so I think we need to be very wise when we're amending our Constitution.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments? Yes, Peter Fisher.
First of all, I've been election judging over a number of years, and I've seen many times where I've turned away a number of people that I knew would live there locally and were entitled to vote, but they didn't have the right ID. They didn't have anyone there to vouch for. In the homeless youth shelter I work at in 2008, most of our youth would not have been able to vote because they did not have IDs, because they couldn't get the birth certificates to get their IDs. That is a problem. And that means those people would not have been able to vote in 2008. And so what it does, it doesn't disenfranchise people. It does not allow them to vote. And we're going to lose more people that way than we have a voter fraud.
Thank you. Anyone else? Chuck Weger.
Madam Moderator, if there's a problem, then let's not be speculative that on what if, because this is going to be very costly and will disenfranchise. I asked when we met with the Washington County delegation, as legislators, we meet with the county board. I asked County Attorney Peter Orpin, how many prosecutions? What's the issue? It's not a problem in Washington County. I asked the same thing in Ramsey County to the delegation, to the election judges. What's the problem? It's not. This is political.
Thank you. Dwayne or Stacy? Nothing? Dwayne?
I was under the impression that there were people in Washington County that had been, they were prosecuted, but I don't have the facts and figures right in front of me right now. I apologize for that.
Stacy, any comments? We'll move on to the next question. Do you believe there is enough money with existing revenue and projected growth, along with possible cuts to some areas, to fund our budget? Or do you believe we need a mix of tax increases and cuts to fund our state's needs? And we will begin with Peter Fisher.
I think right now, with the having worked in a number of different areas over the last few years, that we do not have the resources available to meet the needs going forward. Structurally, we have an imbalance. We owe $2.4 billion to our schools that we still haven't paid from 2 years ago. We also have inflation that's the last few years, and that still leaves us in the hole another $1 billion. We have to take a look at both sides with a balanced approach. We have to take a look at the expense side, but most importantly, we have to take a look at closing at the revenue side and start closing the loopholes that are out there that allow some businesses to operate who are out of state at an advantage over local businesses. I think that's wrong. If we don't start addressing those things, we start putting our local businesses at disadvantage and miss out on opportunities to bring in that revenue to make our community stronger and pay back the education.
Thank you. Dwayne Johnson.
I believe that our main focus has got to be on reining in our budget at this time. There are areas that can be streamlined. There are ways of prioritizing to bring that budget down so that we can live within our means. Each and every one of us here, when times get tough, we have to do that with our budgets at home, and the state, I feel, has to do the same.
Thank you. Stacy Stout.
I think when addressing our budget needs, all options should be on the table. You have to look at the picture in its entirety. And First of all, I think we should start with making sure we're running our every government operation efficiently and that we're saving where we should be saving, because we can always be doing a better job. And so we need to be ensuring that we're doing that first. I think it's important that we increase our revenue base by getting more people working. That's how we get our revenue up. And then we have the resources to be addressing the critical needs that government should be addressing. But in order to do that, it works hand in hand. You've got to get people working, and we do that by ensuring that we have a business-friendly climate. And then once we've got that, then our government should be operating efficiently and effectively to ensure that we're getting the best value as taxpayers.
Thank you. Chuck Wigger.
Yes, government needs to be efficient, and we will go through the budget process where the Constitution requires that it be balanced. So it's not should it, it must be balanced. I disagreed and voted against the borrowing that was put in effect to take money from classrooms from Matamidi, White Bear, and others by borrowing, which is really going to have to be paid back, and that's going to be before us next session. We also have other issues in terms of, you know, programs that have needs, and that would start first with our schools. We also have nursing homes and options on health care in terms of making sure that people have access. Is there greater efficiencies that will be made? Yes. And Spencer Cronk, the commissioner for office management, has got an ambitious program to put in a lot of things. There's things we can do at the legislature. I have sponsored in the past constitutional amendments which would have reduced the size of the legislature, and it did not get a hearing, but I was fine with reducing that, where we need to set that example so there's more efficiencies, and they'll be made, but we also can provide more.
Does anyone have any additional comments? Chuck?
Since that's available, moderator. We need to have a fair taxation system, and I don't believe it's fair for a middle American, or the middle Minnesotan and the middle class to be paying approximately 12% to 13% of their income in taxes, and there's a tax incidence study that documents this, it's nonpartisan, and the middle class is paying about 12% to 13%, but those fortunate enough to be in the upper 2%, and good for them, their effective tax is going to be at 10%. That should be changed. That is fairness, and that will generate additional revenue.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Yes, I would just like to add that right now, Minnesota is the 45th least business-friendly state, so we don't want to increase taxes in any way to make it any worse. We can only go down 5 more.
Thank you. Peter Fisher?
Yeah, several things. Number one is we do have positive things happening. 3M is relocating many jobs and doing a major expansion in Maplewood. The biggest thing that I'm hearing is not so much on the tax side is making sure that we have people who've got these job skills, which we have a shortage of. We need to do that through education. We need the funding available so that the people can get the jobs that the businesses have open. If we don't have the funds to do it, they're not going to get trained, we're not going to have the jobs. We need to have government to be effective besides efficient.
Thank you. Stacy, do you have any comments?
Nothing further.
We'll move on to the next question, which is one of the students who is here. We are in the Black Box Theater at Matamidi High School. I attend this high school, and over the past 4 years, have seen many classes condensed, shortened, or canceled altogether due to the lack of funding. Where does education stand for you, and what do you plan to do about this growing problem? And we'll begin with Chuck Wheeler.
Thank you to the student for sharing that. The education is my number one priority. I was first elected to the school board when I was attending Hamlin at age 21 and have been involved in school issues ever since. Our Constitution, Article 8, addresses the right for education in that we have a uniform system. And it also says it's critical to our democracy in terms of a well-educated population, and there's a lot of rhetoric in Bill of Rights, but what are we going to do? We need to invest more in our schools, and that is why there's been cutbacks, because the resources So investing more in schools, and that's the bottom line, whether you're going to do it, we need to provide assistance. We shouldn't be borrowing, as I mentioned earlier. And I want to compliment Matamidi's, we're here, the Fab Lab and other things are just exemplary of what we need to do to be looking at how we're going to be providing jobs and the whole STEM, science, technology, engineering, math program you have here is great, but we can do more, and I hope we will.
Thank you. Stacy Stout.
Well, as a mom, I have two little boys who I want to see them have the best education possible. And Minnesota has done a lot of things right, but we do have a lot of areas that we can improve. And I think a lot of it comes back to the local level, making sure that our school boards are able to make the decisions that they need to be making. I think that we need to make sure we've got quality teachers in the classroom, and we have great teachers, and they're doing a great job, and we need to make sure that they have all the tools that they need, such as the Fab Lab that Senator Wieger mentioned. I've been able to tour it here at the high school, and it's an amazing program they've got. And I think it's really important that we're making sure we're preparing our students for the jobs of tomorrow. It's the tomorrow's workforce that our children will be entering into, and we've got to make sure they're prepared. So as parents and as community members, I know it's one of the biggest concerns on our mind, and we have to take all of those things into consideration whenever we're putting together our plan for our future education system.
Thank you. Dwayne Johnson.
This is something that does strike home with us at our house, because my daughter is a teacher in St. Paul, part of the teachers union down there, and is on a sabbatical right now. The last 2 years she's been mentoring new teachers coming into the system to help them adjust to from being in classroom as a student to being in the classroom as a teacher. And unfortunately there's a few of them that didn't make the cut. In a way that's sad, but in another way it's good, because we've got better teachers in the school. I spent Sunday afternoon speaking with her about what we need to do in the educational system, because she's right in it. And there are areas that can be cut within the school system. She talks about the fact that every time they come up with a new system, they have to hire a group to come in and set up tests for these things, and then the money goes for that instead of in the classroom where it should be.
Thank you. Peter Fisher.
Education is very important to me. There's a number of things that are impacting our ability to deliver a quality education. All three of my kids attended the public school systems in 622 North St. Paul, Maplewood, and Oakdale. And over the last 15 years, as they went through that school system, I saw a dramatic change. It was impacted by several things. The dramatic change I saw is that the amount of classes that were offered in terms of fine arts are no longer available. A lot of the supports are no longer there because of budget cuts that they had to make at the schools. And this was being driven by a number of things. And number one was coming from the state. Inflation has increased substantially. State funding has not. State funding has only gone up by a fraction. And as a result, we're putting ourselves in a situation that is upside down. At home, we all have to make sure that we account for inflation. In education, we haven't. And as a result, we've been cutting programs to make sure that we can keep within the budgets. And that's going to have a negative impact on our students.
Thank you. Anyone with additional comments? Then we'll move on to the next question, which is also on education. What are your priorities for education policy and funding? And we will begin with Dwayne Johnson.
Well, first of all, we have to have a funding source for the schools so that the superintendents know and the school boards know how much money they can count on every year. And it has to be something that it's going to go from year to year to year. When I worked at 916 several years ago, working with their budgets, it was difficult because every year you'd be getting a different amount of money, and then you had to, if we're losing money in one area, how are we going to pick it up someplace else? We need a sustainable revenue for our schools, and then we have to work with our schools, in high schools and the colleges, to make sure that our students don't have to take remedial math and remedial English when they get into college. That to me is just wrong. It's a waste of time and money. We've got to be able to train these students when they're high school level, so when they get into college, it's just a normal process and they don't have to learn the basics all over again.
Thank you. Chuck Uyghur.
For students, we want them first ready for K, and that is actually a state goal, and half the students are not ready. Imagine how much greater the likelihood of success would be if most, if not all, students were ready. And that means the most important person is going to be the parent, the parents, grandparents, and others, and what they can do. The schools provide a number of programs, and there's nonprofits, but students, first of all, being ready for K, and it's a huge initiative. We talked about this actually today at one of the area businesses in the context of jobs later. The goal of the system is to achieve readiness for college, post-secondary education, and hopefully that you're prepared to be a very good citizen. And how do we fund that? We provide stable funding. We do not put the deep dependence on property tax. That's wrong. I support alternatives to that. And overall, that is very well summed up in what's been called Minnesota Miracle 2, which was offered by Representative Greiling, and I will be supporting a measure somewhat similar to that next session.
Thank you. Peter Fisher.
Education is very critical. We have to work on restoring the funding, and it comes across the entire spectrum. We have to work from early childhood all the way through, not just higher education, but having opportunities for people as they come back. Number one is returning veterans, making sure we have retraining available for them as they come back from overseas. Number two, the long-term unemployed, making sure that we're making retraining available to them, because what's happening is in the upper areas, people are finding that certain industries are no longer viable, and with technology, things move rapidly, and people need to retrain so they can get the education, so that they can get the jobs, so they can pay the taxes to help us in the future. Also on top of that, if we have a strong early childhood, then the kids will be ready when they go to school, and eventually with the proper guidance throughout, they will be ready when they get senior high, and they'll be ready to start when they get to higher education, because most jobs in our future will need a higher degree, whether it be a certificate, a two-year degree, or a four-year degree. If we want our children to be successful, we've got to make sure we're supporting them in that process.
Thank you. Stacy Stout.
I think one of the first things we need to make sure we do is restore the funding to our schools. Our schools need to know how they're going to operate. They need to be able to plan for that. And second, we've got to make sure we've got the best and most qualified teachers in the classroom and that we're maintaining them. And beyond that, as far as funding goes, we've got to make sure we've got a strong economy. It comes back to making sure that we have the resources to fund the programs in our schools and make that available at the local level so that they have all options on the table. That it's with a strong economy that we'll have options and opportunities for our students.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments?
Yes, I do.
Wayne Johnson.
Another thing that I have run across is the fact that when some of our students graduate from a higher education, they have a certificate or they're trained in a certain area, especially with a certificate, when they go out and apply for a job in that area, that certificate is no longer valid. This is not a good situation, because that kid has wasted his time and money for a job that's not there waiting for them. We've got to make sure that any certificates that we are handing out are valid in the industry.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'd just like to add to that. I think it is important that we're working with our businesses and making sure that the schools are learning what the students need to have, what skills they need to have in order to be ready for the jobs of the future, because they are the future workforce. And it's important, I think Dwayne was touching on that, in that when they come out of school, that they are ready for the workplace. And that only happens if we're working in coordination between the schools and the businesses.
Thank you. Anyone else? Chuck Wiggins.
I just want to reassure everyone, there's a lot of that dialogue that's been going on. And the superintendents, various teachers that are involved, the businesses, the President Century College, they're talking, there's a workforce council in this area. I believe there's 19 in the state. They have a mandated expectation to be doing this type of dialogue, to come up with a plan, and it's coordinated through the Minnesota Employment and Economic Development, and there's
programs on that website that show those policy goals.
Thank you. Peter?
Yes, it's very important that we do this, but it's going to take resources. You know, if we are going to have our children properly trained, we need the resources. Representative Minnie Grimes offered a plan that would close a number of loopholes to address that, so we'd have the resources, because without the resources there, you can't provide the services to the youth. And it is very critical that we do that, because once they have the resources, they will have the training, and keeping that fit partnership that we have with businesses and developing the partnerships across the entire community so that we've got a strong education program.
Thank you. We'll move on to our next question. It is said that there are more dollars spent on corporate welfare than taxpayer dollars are spent on welfare programs to the poor or elderly. How is your plan to reduce welfare programs better than that of your opponent? And we'll begin with Peter Fisher.
Wow. I think there is, first of all, in terms of corporate welfare, when you take a look at the tax breaks that favor some industries over others, we have to go in and address that. And I think when I take a look at having worked with people at a disadvantage on a daily basis over the last 5 years, what I find out, most of these people are working very hard. They've been put in terrible situations where banks have foreclosed on their homes, families have been broken up, and kids have nowhere to go. So we're suffering from a number of things. These are people that are working hard. All they need is a little bit of effort and support to be able to get to the next level. We currently have on most of our system limits as to how long people can receive them. One of the problems that we've had is over the last few years is some of the support systems that used to be there have suffered big state budget cuts, and they've closed out. That has left more people homeless or in the criminal justice system at a huge cost over what they would have if we had kept those systems.
Thank you. Wayne Johnson.
Well, one of the things is if you give a large industry a big tax break to move into your state, that indicates that your state has a bad tax system, and that's the only reason you're going to get them into that state. Now, my tax clients, they're not telling me that they got a lot of tax breaks coming. They're complaining because they're getting taxed to death, and they're getting run out of business by rules and regulations that are costing them money that they can't recoup. So we've got to work on making this a fair state for businesses to come into. As I stated before, we're the 45th in the United States as far as being business friendly. And as Stacy has said quite a few times, if we get the economy running pretty good and get it back on track, that's going to take care of a lot of the welfare system.
Thank you. Stacy Stout.
Well, Dwayne started my answer for me, and it is true that we have to make sure that we've got a business-friendly climate here in our state in order to grow jobs. And when we grow jobs, we increase our revenue. And it's only by being a prosperous state that we are able to address the needs of those who are in our system for a reason, that our government has a responsibility to provide for those who can't help themselves. But in order to do that adequately and to really do them justice, then we need to be making sure we've got the resources. And the way we do that is by improving our economy. And so it works hand in hand. I think it's very important that we have a welfare system that is treating those in need adequately and more than adequately. We should not be providing inadequate services by having, you know, not putting the right resources into it. And so by building a stronger economy, then we have the resources and we address those needs as they should be addressed.
Thank you. Chuck Wieger.
Earlier I stated my position on tax fairness. I feel that it's not a level playing field, it's not a level system right now, and I won't say anything further on that, other than that we should do something. Governor Dayton has made that clear. Commissioner Franz with the Minnesota Department of Revenue has had hearings throughout the state, and he has the three-legged stool and shows how the revenue comes in through property sales and income, and how things are out of whack, particularly on property. And we talk about taxation for businesses. There's injustices amongst businesses in terms of how they're treated. So it should be fair, it should be a level playing field. In terms of working with area businesses, I do that almost every day. I manage the area chambers of commerce before I went to Securian, but in my role here as a senator, I'm frequently talking to people. I worked in a bipartisan way with Senator Chamberlain to sponsor the sales tax exemption on the purchase of capital equipment, tax increment financing with Oakdale businesses, and we will reintroduce that again next session.
Thank you. Does anyone have any additional comments?
Yes.
Peter Fisher.
First of all, I want to say we need to have a balanced approach, looking and always examining both the revenue and the expense side. But I think what's real important is, in terms of business climate, what I remember critically from running small businesses is the most important thing was having consumer spending. If we didn't have consumer spending, we aren't able to create the jobs, and that's a big part of the problem right now, is if the people in the middle class don't have the money, they aren't able to spend it. As a result, you have fewer people buying things, and that is where the biggest driver in our economy is, and so that's what we have to focus on.
Thank you. Anyone else? Wayne Johnson.
I'll raise my hand this time. On the area of welfare, we have to make that work to help the people get out of welfare, to not keep them. I always want to say on the reservation, and my wife says don't say that, but we got to help them get off and into the economy again, and not get them just enough to get by. We got to have some kind of a sliding scale so that when they start earning money, their benefits don't just get cut off at a certain point.
Thank you.
I'd like to talk more about this, but.
Thank you. Anyone else? Chuck Wigger.
Did you know there are over 3 million jobs that are unfilled in the country? Thousands of them here in Minnesota. And the reason, and when it gets back to education, and the workers are needed, and it's primarily in the high-tech areas where those certificates need to stand and actually say what the employers need, and that was the focus of our meeting today. We need to improve and continue working on that connection between the workforce needs here in Minnesota and with education, and then that ticket out of poverty and the win-win situation helps the economy as well.
Thank you, Stacy. Do you have any comments? No. It is time to move to closing statements, and we will begin with Stacy Stout.
Well, thank you again for hosting this event. Thank you to everyone for being here. I'll just recap a little bit. As I mentioned before, I live here in Matamidi with my husband, Tim, and our two boys, and community is very important to us. Our boys are learning to swim at the same YMCA that my husband learned to swim at many years ago, and just really care about our community here. I really feel like my experience, having worked on legislative policy, worked on cybersecurity, telecom, identity theft, fraud, a lot of issues that are very important to all of us in our community, I feel like that background and experience would serve us very well in a representative. And I really am committed to making sure we have a quality education. As a mom of two little boys who have their whole education ahead of them, I want to make sure we're doing the right things for our schools and putting our students first. I want to make sure that we have a job-friendly climate. It's not up to government to create jobs, but it's up to the government to foster an environment where we can grow jobs. And we need that. We need it desperately in the state so that we can get all the government resources that we need to be addressing all the needs of our state, and that it works hand in hand. And so, and along with that, being a fiscally responsible government, making sure that we're not funding programs we shouldn't be funding, eliminating waste where there's waste, and streamlining the programs that should be streamlined so that we're getting the best value of our tax dollars. Thank you so much. I would be honored to have your vote.
Thank you. Next with this closing statement is Peter Fisher.
I want to first of all thank the League of Women Voters, everyone here tonight, everyone watching on TV, for the opportunity to be able to talk and help educate us on the issues tonight. I feel that I'm very uniquely qualified to be able to represent us in the future. I have deep roots within the community that has allowed me to understand where we are, where we've been, and where we'd like to be going. It is important that we work together to make sure that we solve our problems. It's not something that we're going to be able to solve by combating as we have over the last few years. It's important that we build the partnerships and relationships. That's something I committed to, something that I'd like to follow, somebody that I think very highly of who's done well on that is Carol McFarland. She's done a great job on that type of relationship building between the parties, and I'm hoping I can follow in her footsteps in doing some of those type of efforts going forward. And that means using a balanced approach. It means that when we're taking a look at the issues before us, in terms of finance, the financial expertise I have, in terms of running operations from a business, I can sit there and make the hard choices and decide, is it going to be good for us long-term? Is it going to be good for us short-term? And also with that compassion of people so that we're making sure that we're supporting those working hard to improve themselves in life. I feel that our community has real needs and we have to focus on them. And I'm committed to making education jobs a priority again. And that's why I'm asking for your vote tonight. Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Next with his closing statement is Wayne Johnson.
Well, thank you again for coming out tonight and listening to us. I appreciate it. I would very much like to be your senator and represent you in this area. And doing that, I would bring fiscal responsibility to our state budget. And I would also bring 30 years of working in separate industries into the equation. I've worked with AFSCME. I worked with them for 3 years. I worked for school boards, or not school boards, excuse me, 916, when it was Special Intermediate School District 916, now Century College. I've also worked with nonprofit organizations where we had a school for kids that this was their last resort. If they didn't make it there, they were out on their ear, period. They didn't have any future. So I've worked with all of these different areas, and I can see the different problems that each one of these have, and I can work towards making a consensus and bringing us all together to solve the problems that are facing this country and this state, and willing to make the hard decisions that go along with that. So I appreciate your vote, and thank you again for coming out tonight.
Thank you. Next with this closing statement is Chuck Wiegert.
Thank you, everyone, for being here, and thank you, Mr. Johnson. I appreciate you being a true gentleman and a very honorable campaign, and it's been nice getting to know you more. I love public service. I love this community. It's my roots for generations. It's been an honor serving, and I humbly ask for your consideration again. You're not going to perhaps agree with me on every issue, nor may you with your friends on every single issue. It's a complex, divided society, but I pledge, and you know, for those of you that know me well, I'm very dedicated, I work very hard, and I'm a consensus builder. And I do that when working with the chamber and with labor, and that's how I worked as a school board member, and it's perhaps why I'm endorsed by over 20 organizations representing a cross-section from business to labor, police, firefighters, and others. Have I performed in office in terms of what I've said? There's always going to be challenges. Well, I have been recognized by a lot of the groups, Legislator of the Year by the American Heart Association during the past session on bringing up various public health issues, recognition by various health organizations, by veterans groups, VFW and American Legion, Legislator of the Year, environmental groups as well. I only say that as I take this job very seriously. And I communicate, I have a regular cable show that's on every day. I do e-updates, town meetings. Call me at 770-0283 if you'd like to talk more. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Those are your candidates for Senate District 43 and House District 43A. Now I'm delighted to introduce the National President of the League of Women Voters, Elizabeth McNamara.
Well, thank you very much, and thank all of you all for coming out here tonight. Thank you to the candidates for participating in this forum. I have been traveling around the country during this election season, encouraging folks to come out and vote, and because this is such an important election, as all elections are. And the proud tradition of the League of Women Voters, both here in Minnesota and all across the country, of bringing communities together in events like this, so that voters can ask their questions of candidates and get the information that they need to bring to make up their own minds, is a tradition that we've carried on for over 90 years. And so I hope that all of you have had a good experience here this evening, have learned a lot, have the information, or feel like you have the information you need to participate on Election Day, to get out there and vote, and encourage everybody in your community to get out and vote. And as I understand from everything I'm learning here in Minnesota over the last couple of days, you all have a wonderful tradition of being the state with the highest voter turnout in the United States. Long may that tradition continue, and I certainly hope that this debate, this forum this evening, has been of help to you, because it certainly has been the pleasure of the League of Women Voters to bring you this opportunity. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the candidates for their participation tonight. We also thank the Matamidi School District for the use of this facility, the Ramsey Washington Suburban Cable Commission Production Services Department for videotaping this event, plus our league volunteers and you, the audience, for your attendance and interest. Cable TV playback of this forum may be seen on Ramsey Washington's cable channel 18 through Saturday, November 3rd. Playback will begin Tuesday, October 16th at 8 p.m., and playback thereafter will be every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday at 10 a.m. and 8 p.m. A video of this forum will also be available shortly at the Wildwood Library. And remember to vote Tuesday, November 6th. Thank you, and good night.